Becoming the Man, Chapter 3, The Humble Beginnings of Mr. White. Mr. White was born in a small mining town in western Pennsylvania alongside two brothers, one older and one younger. His father was Richard White and his mother was Laura White. His parents were in no way racist. He watched his father wake up hours before sunrise to work in a coal mine that seemed to sustain the whole little town. His mother did all of the things that mothers in those days would do. She cooked, she cleaned, she sewed, she was the mediator of all things family, and she became the glue that kept everything together. Both of his parents stressed the importance of an education to ensure a better, more comfortable life. His older brother, Roger White, went on to follow in his dad's footsteps and work at the coal mine, a job that would later lead to a fatal lung infection. Mr. White became the first of the Whites to graduate from college. To this day, he is one of the most acclaimed students to have went to the state university. Buddy White, Mr. White's younger brother, went into the carpet business. He found a job after school helping out at a local carpet store and learned every aspect of the business. He would later go on to open 6 stores of his own throughout western Pennsylvania and make a really good living for himself. The work ethic of a coal miner was in their blood and hearts. Mr. White's fondest memories were from his childhood days in small-town America. If he looked past all of the numbers and data that took up most of the storage in his mind, he could see, like snapshots, picturesque mountain views and his blue-collar family conversing at the dinner table, which his grandfather made by hand and had passed down. He could smell the elaborate Sunday meals his mother made, to the point where if he thought about it hard enough, his stomach would rumble with a memory-induced hunger. Those simple times in life prepared him well for the more complex ones he would encounter later. After excelling in high school academically, as well as being a respectable athlete, he went on to the state university and studied sociology. He found the workings of society very interesting. Studying never seemed like studying, and soon he would find himself at the top of his class. The way he was able to hold on to facts and his curiosity of the world allowed him to thrive and excel so naturally. Everyone on campus, especially his professors, knew he had the qualities to go on and do big things. This promise of certain success in life not only made his hard-working parents proud, but attracted the big brown eyes of Victoria Feltman. Before Victoria Feltman would become Mrs. White and then Victoria Feltman again, she was the daughter of a very well-to-do doctor from Massachusetts. Her father had urged her not to go to college because he felt like it was a waste of her time and his money. In those days, most men saw the kitchen as a woman's place and a homemaker as a woman's purpose. Victoria was full of lofty dreams, however, and eventually her desire to leave her prim and proper world won her father over. He agreed to foot the bill and she headed to university to study liberal arts. She went to school hoping to meet a husband just as much, if not more, than to get a degree. She had always been well taken care of, and this was reflected in her physical appearance. She had a perfect smile, a light olive complexion, and dark brown hair. Had she chose, she could have been a Hollywood actress with looks so stunning. Whereas she traveled around Europe on summer breaks from school with her father, Dr. Feltman, Mr. White's furthest excursions at the time had been an occasional trek to the New Jersey shore. He saw the world through textbooks and National Geographic, and she saw the world through her deep brown eyes. These same eyes lit up and fell in love with Mr. White at first glance. Mr. White wasn't quite an introvert, but he only spoke when deemed necessary. Watching his father toil in a coal mine taught him that it's one's actions that are the foundation of one's reputation. He could visualize every piece of dirt that his father wore home at night to earn that modest living. It made college a breeze. Victoria saw him one day while refilling books at the library, where through her father's connections, she had landed a coveted job, one of the only paying ones on the campus available for students. He paid her no attention as she did her best to catch his eye. This made her like him more. Usually guys would make sure to return their books even a day late if need be while she was working. Yet Mr. White casually dropped his books on the Yucatan Peninsula in the proper slot without looking twice and headed to his own unpaid internship at the sociology department. That whole semester, Victoria had a keen interest in the strong guy from the hills who practically lived in the library. She was even more attracted to him when she asked around and found that he was 2 years older. It would be a chance encounter in the mess hall, however, that would align their world of opposites. Mr. White had built a suitable routine for himself. He would map out his week every Sunday evening and would do his best to follow it. Nothing in his 3 years at the university had broken the cycle of his routines and to-do lists. All of that would change, however, when due to construction on the other side of campus, the mess hall he frequented at 1 p.m., 12:15 p.m. on Thursdays, would be so crowded his usual seat by the window would be occupied. He scanned the room, looking for a place and space enough to eat his roast beef sandwich, mashed potatoes, and carrots. In the cafeteria that was now serving twice the traffic, he saw only two open seats. One was next to Jim Yop, who he knew would most likely talk to him the whole time, just as he had when they took a required math test together, and the other was next to an absolutely gorgeous brunette who looked familiar, but he wasn't sure from where. He chose the latter and almost missed the opportunity, wondering where he knew her from. He moved swiftly about 30 feet and casually asked, "Is this seat taken?" Victoria, assuming that Mr. White had bigger plans than simply eating his lunch, replied, "Why, no, sir, it's not." And those were the first words spoken between the two, much more pleasant than the last words that would be spoken between the two. The familiarity of the beautiful brunette distracted Mr. White so much that he had to inquire. He politely asked, "Excuse me, but do I know you from somewhere?" He thought maybe they shared a class together, or even she had lived in his small town and somehow they never crossed paths. "I don't believe we've ever met," she replied. She was trying not to let on that she had studied him as many times as he had studied the books on world civilizations in the library. He had been taught from an early age to have a great deal of respect for women, as his father tried to mold him into a man of honor. She quickly inserted in a flirtatious manner, "My name is Victoria, Victoria Feltman, and the pleasure is all mine." It was at this point that Mr. White really started to notice her wonderful features. Up to this point, college had been the smell of plastic covers on top of dull green history books and the constraints of a well-calculated schedule. But at this very moment, his world opened up. For the next minute, there was an awkward silence as both students picked up their lunches, trying to think of a way to get the conversation going. Victoria would be the one to do so. "So how is sociology going for you?" she asked. She was using her secret crush on the small-town boy as leverage. This threw Mr. White off a bit. "It's going well, but," he replied. Victoria interrupted, "How do I know you study sociology?" "Well, you can learn a lot from working at the library. I practically know what everybody at this university studies, or doesn't study for that matter." She gave a devilish grin. Mr. White was far from a Casanova, but he could sure tell that Victoria must have seen him before, and now the slight familiarity made sense. "Wow, the library! That's where I know you from. You looked so familiar. To think I must have seen you 100 times. Once again, the fact that Mr. White had overlooked her on dozens of occasions made him so much more attractive and made this meeting even more special. Victoria and Mr. White would talk at the library every time he would return his books. This led to them studying together. Studying led to them attending social mixers together. The mixers led to them dating exclusively, and by the time Mr. White was looking to graduate, Victoria would be looking to leave school altogether, with a sure proposal being around the corner. Mr. White was at the top of his class and on top of the world. It was hard finding a girl in rural Pennsylvania who had seen the places he dreamed of going, but at the state college he found his perfect match. Victoria loved that besides being so sharp and logical, his blue-collar upbringing gave him the skills to fix things when they broke and be totally self-sufficient. She was used to guys who had been given the silver spoon before they were off of the baby food. Her father was more than happy for her to meet a man and put all of the college nonsense to rest. Mr. White graduated, proposed, and soon thereafter was hand-selected for a job interview with the United States government. Mr. White took the trip to Washington, D.C. to be interviewed for a top-secret government job on a perfect spring day. He felt totally confident, having recently met the woman of his dreams. You know, the right woman can make a man feel unstoppable. He took a bus from Philadelphia that arrived in Washington, D.C. a whole day before the appointment to assure that he would be well prepared. He checked into his modest hotel room and then toured the many museums that the nation's capital had to offer. For as nice as the scenery was, it was a time of unrest in America because Martin Luther King had been assassinated just a month before. This had an effect on Mr. White because he saw Dr. King as a good man, and he had never been raised to be biased or racist. He actually found it silly that people, especially in the South, could deny human beings of their basic rights. He walked along the green where Dr. King had delivered his powerful "I Have a Dream" speech and wondered quietly where the man's life could have gone had it not been cut short so suddenly by the bullet of ignorance. After treating himself to dinner at a more upscale restaurant near his hotel, he retired early to get a good night's sleep for the big day. The wake-up call came at the proper time, but it was unnecessary because Mr. White had been awake since 6:30 a.m. He wasn't the least bit nervous, maybe just a little anxious to show that he had the work ethic and the book knowledge to handle whatever this job he had been handpicked to interview for might entail. He caught public transit to the government building and made his way to the visitor's desk. "Hello, I'm..." Before he could even finish his sentence, the brunette behind the desk answered, "Mr. White, I assume. We're ready for you. There's no need for you to even wait. You can head back to room 112. They await you." This made Mr. White feel very important, as if the U.S. government was relying on him to function properly during such a turbulent time. He headed down the hall, walked into the room, and was greeted by an elderly gentleman with balding gray hair and a more heavy set. He seemed very serious and stressed. Mr. White knew he was of importance, but he never remembered seeing him in the newspaper or on the Senate floor or on the newsreels. "Mr. White," the man asked, "my name is Thomas Giles. I personally selected you out of thousands of potential candidates to interview for this job. The fact that you're here basically means you have the job if you want it. Of course, you will have to pass security clearances and the standard background checks, but honestly, if you made it this far, that means my people have already checked you out." This was a lot for Mr. White to process, and he realized he hadn't even greeted the man back. "Well, thank you, Mr. Giles. It's an honor to be regarded so highly by the United States government, and the pleasure is all mine," said Mr. White.
"Great, great. Now let me get down to the business at hand. If you would, have a seat," replied Thomas Giles. "What I'm going to explain to you is a whole lot to process, and in our business, there's no time to waste. We feel like you're the only person for this job, based on your background, your temperament, your grades, and most importantly, your character. You seem to understand how things work. We've been watching you for a while. We have people up at the state university that do these types of things. You're in a position to make a lot of money for the rest of your life if you find that this is the job for you. However, this job comes with a ton of responsibility, total secrecy, and many more intricacies. You get to make your own hours, and you'd never have to be in the public eye. It'll give you power that no man in America has, and you will be a pivotal character in the future of this great nation of ours."
Mr. White was waiting for someone to come in and say it was some kind of joke that all applicants had played on them, but Mr. Giles continued, totally serious.
"See, we need someone young and gifted such as yourself, with your even temperament and lack of political ties, to run a program that we've been running since the late 1800s. Right now, I'm running this program, but the whole Dr. King thing as well, how can I put it, made me want to retire. I am what we here in the government call the man. At this point, I can't give you any more details. If you're interested in hearing more, there's some paperwork you must fill out due to confidentiality clauses, and we will put you up in a hotel for a few weeks while you go through a sort of orientation. Remember, secrecy is synonymous with the position, so is learning more and being set for life financially. Is that something you're interested in?"
Mr. White had run through a million different scenarios in his mind before the interview, trying to anticipate what kind of job he would interview for, but this was something that no man would have been able to predict. It seemed too good to be true. This would be his first job offer out of college, and the U.S. government was talking about setting him up financially for life. He was eager to hear what this exciting job might entail. He also knew that they might have five more people just like him on standby in case he said no, and he was ready to start his life with Victoria. Mr. White replied, "Thank you for this opportunity, Mr. Giles. The job sounds very intriguing, to say the least. I would like all of the details." Mr. Giles answered,
"Good, son, good. We're going to get you set up for the week in the best hotel in Washington, D.C., way better than that place you stayed last night. Starting tomorrow, we will go over all of the details and fill out the proper paperwork. Remember, you are to tell no one what transpired today, and after you fill out the paperwork, you will face legal ramifications if you decide to talk too much."
"I understand, sir," replied Mr. White. He was given the information to his new hotel, and he called Victoria to carefully explain that he would be in D.C. for the remainder of the next week and that things were looking very good. He added that if things went well, they might even be moving to Washington, D.C. soon. Victoria couldn't believe it and was very excited at the possibility of conquering a new metropolis.